Can you design innovation into a city? Michael Eales is helping cities across Australia attract connected, inspired citizens to live, work, and create. As a business designer and strategist, he helps leaders ignite impact with more collaborative and innovative ways of working. Welcome, Michael. You've been doing a lot of work lately with government agencies. What are they coming to you for? What kind of help are they looking to get from you?
We've found that today there's an absolute awareness now that the problems that we've been trying to solve for a long time aren't being solved using the ways that have got us to where we are. And so a lot of the leaders, the public officers that we work with in government, tend to have a mindset which is we need to approach this from a different point of view. And that starts with actually coming with the beginner's mindset. So not assuming we have a solution that's quite linear in terms of the pathway, but rather it's going to be messy. And in that regard, we're seeing an absolute step change in the way many governments are now talking about policy design. And when we look at the role of a department, for example, the Department of Industry or the Department of Employment in Australia, you're seeing now the leaders in these areas giving themselves permission to experiment, to fail. And in many ways, that's a significant mindset shift. So we're absolutely bringing the user, or in this case, the citizen, to the centre and ensuring that we're breaking down the quite often high bureaucratic barriers in terms of the traditional way of navigating these challenges, and ensuring that the staff of the government agencies are actually in the field with the customer.
That seems pretty revolutionary, having government agencies spend time with the citizens trying to understand their needs. What was that like? Can you give us an example of an experience?
Yeah, so one that I'm quite fond of was some work we did with the Department of Industry in Australia. The streamlining of government was a major trigger for the merger of two areas of this department. And one area was the funding arm. The other side of the department was the Enterprise Connect team, and their whole focus was to say yes to help business. So the cultural differences here was one area of this department was very much focused on saying yes to helping business. The other one was often saying no, because we don't have infinite money. So there was a pivotal moment where bringing these two teams together, and what we were able to explore and experiment with there was having these business owners actually tell their story. And for the first time in many cases, be able to translate the pressures that they were feeling as business owners in having to go through the process of asking for funding and jumping through all the hoops. So in the end, this particular department decided, well, we needed to emphasize providing a service to business first and foremost before we talk about the funding. And so now in Australia, you see this quite large program called the Entrepreneurs Infrastructure Program, which talks about this concept of infrastructure as an enabler. We're now seeing the funding being almost a secondary conversation to understanding where the business value is being captured.
Michael, you work with a wide range of clients, including cities. You're working right now with a city in Australia to help them design the future of cities. Can you tell us about that project?
Yeah, so the city is the city of Springfield, or the greater Springfield community. And it's a massive project. It's got huge ambitions to be the future city as an exemplar for how you design a community and a city from the bottom up. So 25 years ago, the city was designed as a master plan community, which is one of two in Australia, Canberra being the head office of the Australian government, and then Springfield. And this vision that was set by the founder Mahasinapanthi was to create a city built on pillars, and the pillars were health, education, energy, and ICT. Where that's taken us to today is this big ambition around the convergence of the role a community can bring to design the future of a city for itself. And we frame that as the Idea City, which is innovation, design, entrepreneurship, and the arts. An Idea City is an example of a petri dish, a living lab, we might call it. And this living lab is now being open to the world to bring the world's biggest corporates, such as GE. GE's head office for Australia is based in Springfield, to co-design and work with the community to design the community of the future, which ultimately is the city. And all a city is a collection of lots of people coming together, and the collisions of that human condition create a beautiful petri dish to experiment for the future.
Can you walk us through, how did you get to this idea of the idea city? What were some of the steps you took in order to get people aligned on this big vision?
So we apply a methodology that actually translates across many ways of working, but in the first part of this methodology, we unpack understanding. So that's looking at the world around us, understanding the contextual insights that are really the trends and the patterns that are shifting the world that we live in, and looking at how that translates and relates to our vision and our ambition and our aspirations. So if we can get an alignment between our purpose, our vision, and the context of the world we live in, we can create the future together.
That seems like a pretty big task right there. Were there some specific tools or ways that you got people to get aligned on that vision?
Yes, we actually created a series of workshops and engagement strategies to bring in not only the community, but the corporates, the businesses, and the public sector leaders to come together and co-design what this ambitious vision for the future might look like. So Idea City as a vision came from a coming together of people across all areas of the community to actually define what that ambition will look like for the future of this city.
So having an idea, getting aligned is one thing. Putting it into action is a totally different thing. What happened next?
So in exploring that, we actually applied a lens which we call shaping options and generating options for the future design. So that's making sure that we don't try to stay on one path, but give ourselves various scenarios to explore. So Idea City, through the combination of these themes, innovation, design, entrepreneurship, and the arts, allows us to explore the pathways for a community to create value for the future. And what we did there is we looked at the mechanics that anchor the community to a role within the city. So the businesses that operate within the city, we were able to work with them to look at their motivations and how they wanted to create value. And we did that through various tools that we use. And one of those tools is the business model canvas. And we were able to look at how we unpack and create value as a community.
So let me see if I get this straight. You mapped the value of a city on a canvas.
We did. And we looked at it through a portfolio lens. So we really looked at the role of all the different stakeholders. And we said, if you're GE, how do you show up? If you're Cisco, how do you show up? If you're a small startup, how do you show up? And what are the enablers? So what are those ingredients that are required to bring everyone together? And so we were able to create little innovation hubs. So one of our partners in this program, Little Tokyo 2, showed up, and that little business, which in many ways is a scaling business, was about bringing the community together in a central place to start to author what this ambition will look like for the future.
So all these different players could find themselves in this larger map of creating value for this master plan.
Absolutely.
And the city. What happened then?
So then we've gone through a process of actually identifying how we bring all these multi-party stakeholders together to create innovation that's actionable. So we shaped a framework, and that framework was about aligned objectives and agreements to contribute value and bring your resources and capabilities to the table so that we can actually execute on some of the big ambitions we have. And so under the pillars, we've got, for example, the future of energy or the future of mobility as that relates, also the future of health. So one of the big projects right now that the city is working on is anchored around the future of health and health services. And it's a very ambitious project wrapped around the hospital as a space and place of well-being as opposed to illness, for example. And how that hospital in the community connects and relates to the youngest people in the community, to the oldest people in the community.
And where are you today?
So today we're actually at a point where, at the end of March 2017, we're launching the Idea Lab concept. So this is one of the first living labs that's being privately funded in Australia in cooperation and collaboration with our national science agency, CSIRO, with organisations like GE, and also the types of stakeholders from the local community, such as the general practitioner that runs the clinic down the road, and the small businesses that actually are party to this city. So where we are today is at a space where we're setting up the experiments we want to start to run. So we're designing those experiments, and we expect to start actually delivering on those in the next couple of years.
Really trying to see if you can bring a city to life that creates value for a variety of different players that live there, that work there, that will thrive there.
Absolutely.
Very exciting work. Thank you.
Thank you.